Your Highnesses, to your tour, to pua tamasese, to aisi, to puola, to funga efi, and masiofo filifilia tamasese, we are truly humbled by your presence this evening. Pro Chancellor Mr. Winston Thompson, Vice Chancellor and President Professor Rajesh Chandra, USB Senior Management, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the final public lecture and keynote in the Our Sea of Islands seminar series, jointly hosted by the Oceania Centre, USB IT Services, and the USB Anniversary Committee. Before we begin the formalities this evening, I invite the Oceania Dance Theatre and Pacifica Voices on stage for a short, welcoming performance to complement tonight's keynote on Indigenous knowledge, creative arts, and higher education in the Pacific. Prior to that, I would just ask Calvin Rory, Melanesian Outreach Coordinator, just to play a few more melodies from the Whangu Whangu. And from yesterday, we realize the love of His Highness of the sound of the Whangu Whangu, which reminds him of his time in Tonga. And as you know, or may not know, this was the instrument that they used to awaken the royals. So you will all be royals tonight by the Whangu Whangu, played by Kevin Bore. Pinaka. Thank you so much, Calvin, for those moving and soothing melodies. We will now ask Ani, who is one of the sopranos from Pacifica Voices, to come forward to sing an operatic arrangement of a traditional Samoan song. And this is probably a good discussion for a question for His Highness as well. And this is an arrangement I did of a song well known in Samoa called La'u Rosai, translated My Rose. And Ani will sing this. And Ani was invited to Australia last year at the Opera House to sing, and such is the talent here in Fiji and also the Pacific that we want to elaborate on that. So tonight, ladies and gentlemen, please, a big hand for Ani singing La'u Rosai.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Annie, for that wonderful singing. We now will welcome Oceania Dance Theatre through, who will perform a piece inspired by Loma Loma. And this is to Levu, who is one of the coordinators. And he choreographed this piece called Loma Loma, and it's actually the village where his mum hails from. Ladies and gentlemen, please, another big hand for Oceania Dance Theatre. Naka. you so much, Oji, and your dance theater, and that's the younger generation, and it's great to see our young ones come through as well. So thank you also to our choreographer and coordinator, Tu Levu. We now move on to Pacifica Voices, who will be singing an a cappella number, and this number hails from Bau, and Kombau na Yanuanu, and this is obviously about Bau and the prominence in the mid-1800s. It became Fiji's dominant power until its cession to Britain, and it has maintained its influence in politics and leadership right through to modern Fiji. Musical director is Mr. Dan Fox. Thank you so much, Pacifica Voices. We now come to the concluding number by Oceania Dance Theatre. And this final number, it's Fenua, and choreographed by the late Sayuli Tuilangi Alan Alo, and the founding artistic director at Oceania Centre. And this is very famous now, and people will recognize Alan's various movements. And I'm sure His Highness recognizes some of these movements from the South Pacific Games 2007, as well as the Commonwealth Youth Games in Samoa 2015. Ladies and gentlemen, please, a big hand for Oceania Dance Theatre performing Fenua.
Thank you.
Fakalevu, thanks so much, Oceania Dance Theatre, for that. I now invite the University Pro-Chancellor, Mr. Winston Thompson, to deliver the welcome address. Mr. Winston Thompson, thank you.
I think whatever our mother language, those performances would have inspired and uplifted us in preparation for the talk from His Highness this evening. Your Highnesses, Tuya tu tupu tamisese, taisi tupuola tufunga efi, and masiofo filifilia tamisese. Vice Chancellor, President, Professor Rajesh Chandra, USP Senior Management, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. It is an honor and a personal pleasure on behalf of the university community to welcome your highnesses to deliver the keynote address at this final seminar presentation in the Our Sea of Islands seminar series, jointly hosted by the Oceania Center, USP IT Services, and the USP 50th Anniversary Steering Committee. It is indeed a rare privilege to have with us a distinguished scholar, a former head of state and a head of government of Samoa, and a former USP Chancellor preside this evening to deliver a keynote address on Indigenous knowledge, creative arts, and higher education. USP has a vital role to play in promoting Pacific culture, and this seminar series, which is one of the 50th anniversary's activities this year, explores the issues relating to this objective and examines the role that USP should play moving forward into the future. For there is no better exponent on the role, value, and critical importance of our Pacific Islands cultures than Your Highness. As the premier higher education institution in the Pacific region and one of only two regionally owned and governed universities in the world, USP is unique with a commensurate responsibility to help ensure the sustainability of our cultural foundations. The university offers programs through a variety of modes and technologies throughout USP's 14 campuses. Advanced communication technologies through USPNet are used to reach distance and flexible learning students across the vast expanses of our Pacific Ocean. The multicultural nature of the staff and student body gives USP an exceptional character. Serving 12 member countries and covering 33 million square kilometers of ocean, an area more than three times the size of Europe. The population of the 12 USP nations vary in size from Tokelau with only 1,600 people to Fiji with more than 800,000. The total population of our region is 1.3 million. It is culturally and linguistically diverse with a wide range of development and educational challenges. The 50th anniversary of the university presents an opportunity for reflection on the path that the institution has traveled, and more importantly, to review the lessons learned to help chart the pathways into the future. It also provides a prominent forum for discussion on the role that USP has played in the preservation and promotion of Pacific cultures in the past, and is therefore a wonderful vehicle for the Our Sea of Islands seminar series. As a former Chancellor of the University and as Head of State and Head of Government of one of our member nations, Your Highness holds a unique perspective from the lens of both a Pacific Island leader and a titular head of this university. This perspective offers an unparalleled insight in relation to the continuing integration of traditional knowledge and religion into modern thinking and within the academic teaching, learning, and research context of this university. Your Highness, we look forward to your deliberations this evening, and we thank you again for your willingness to take time to deliver this keynote address. Inaka vakulevu fafitai telava.
Thank you so much, Prime Chancellor, for that welcome. We are indeed privileged to have this opportunity to attend this keynote presentation this evening. Lefionga le tama inga, His Highness Tuya Tua Tupua Tamasese Ta Isi Tupuola Tufunga Efi is Samoa's former head of state and held this position from 2007 to 2017. He was a former Prime Minister of Samoa, was the leader of the Samoa Democratic United Party, and a member of the Parliament of Samoa from 1966 to 2004. He holds nationally recognized traditional chiefly titles and is seen across Samoa to be one of her leading cultural custodians. He is recognized internationally for his work on what he describes as Samoa's indigenous reference. He has published articles in scholarly journals and books in the English and Samoan languages. Suesoe Manongi, In Search of Fragrance, Huia publishes second print, 2018. Whispers and Vanities, Samoan Indigenous Knowledge and Religion, Huia publishes 2014. Ia Whanganaina Oio Le Tuawhetalai, Pacific Printers and Publishers, 1989. His Highness is chairperson of the Eleai Singau Matau Naolingawa Lofa Charitable Trust based in Samoa, which seeks to promote and develop Samoan indigenous knowledge resources. I now most respectfully give the platform to His Highness to deliver the keynote address. Ladies and gentlemen, His Highness.
University of the South Pacific Pro-Chancellor Mr. Winston Thompson, Vice-Chancellor and President Professor Rajesh Chandra and your good lady Mrs. Chandra, members of the senior management team, distinguished guests and members of the diplomatic corps. Before I speak or give you my address, I want to say that the word defangfangu in Samoan means gentle awakening. There could not be a warmer or more gentle awakening than that I have received. Thank you very much. Se I mai le mui a tau mai na o le puai ula. Harvest the royal roots, pick only the most fragrant of whajipani. Indigenous knowledge, creative arts, and higher education in the Pacific. There is a common saying, tau mai na o le puai ula. Se I mai na le mui a'a. Pick only the most fragrant of frangipani. Harvest the royal roots. It is both a directive and a gentle plea. I wish to reverse the order of this saying so that I begin with the notion of se I mai le mui a'a. The idea of harvesting royal roots and end with the message of tau mai na o le puai ula, the imperative of picking only those flowers worthy enough to be woven into a special lei or garland for presenting and gifting. Se I mai le mui a'a, to harvest royal roots. Se I mai le mui a'a, to harvest royal roots, mui a'a is a term that refers to the end part of the awa or kava plant, which includes the roots and stem. A'a is the word for root, as in a'a, or le la'au, or roots of a plant or tree. The prefix mui is an abbreviation of the word muli, for the word was originally mulioa, meaning only the end parts of the Ava plant. Samoan orators of old played around with words in this way for speaking ease and poetic punch, so that today we have the abbreviated word muya. It is a term mainly used to describe the long-stemmed ava roots specially grown and harvested for the use in royal ava or kava ceremony. The ava fatupu, and once the ritual starts, they are then deliberately crushed by the chewing, not by grounding using an implement. They are chewed by the designated attendants in the royal ava ceremony. Ava or kava can be found across Polynesia in both Samoa and Fiji. One oral history tale from the village of Vailele Inupolu, Samoa, well known across Samoa, finds that the ava plant came to Samoa from Fiji. The account is recorded and kept alive in the chants and honorifics used in the Samoan ava ceremony. In particular, the name Aano Tamari, recitation of these names and performing the associated rituals and chants keep these oral histories alive. They commemorate a shared Polynesian history and identity. They tell of a common heritage and indigenous Polynesian origins. In traditional Polynesian cultures, names and rituals are important. They were and are used to record our histories and values. For Samoans, if you pay close attention to the words used by orators in the ava ritual, you will find cultural meaning and nuance, history and theology. You will gain insight into the values of our forebears and learn that we have been traveling the seas and interacting with each other long before the white man came to our shores with their ships. There is redemption in knowing this. In the ava story, the names of the children of the Tuifiti, king of Fiji, to his two Samoan wives, Uala and Malo Mamae, who were sisters and Taulasea, traditional healers, commemorates a story of kinship between Samoa and Fiji. It was Uala and Malo Mamae who helped to heal a Tuifiti's daughter from a life-threatening condition. The story goes, there were once two sisters, Uala and Malo Mamae. They were responsible for the care of their grandfather, Tuisunga of Whangarii. One day, Tuisunga craved tuitui, sea urchins, and so sent the girls to collect some for him. Along the way, the girls got bored and decided to do something else. When their grandfather found them idling and the basket not yet full, he got angry. He scolded and banished them. The girls left and walked towards Murifonua, where they came across a boat sent by the Tuifiti. The Tuifiti's daughter had taken ill, and he had sent emissaries to Samoa to find a fofo, traditional healer. The two girls decided to help. The route back to Fiji from Samoa was not only not easy, and the girls thought they might die before having the chance to heal the Tuifiti's daughter. Eventually, they reached Fiji safely. When they arrived, the Tuifiti was waiting anxiously. He asked the captain whether he had found a fofo. The captain pointed to the two girls coming towards them with their basket of traditional healing remedies, including Vaisami Pala, a fermented coconut concoction. When the two sisters reached the Tuifiti's daughter, one massaged her stomach area and the other helped to imbibe the fermented coconut drink. In what seemed a few seconds, the Tuifiti witnessed with joy the sudden recovery of his daughter. Seeing that their work was done, the two girls said they were ready to return to Samoa. The Tuifiti, indebted to the two sisters, asked them to stay so he could show his gratitude. Both stayed on and eventually became his wives. With Wala, he had 3 children, and with Malo Mamai, he had 1. Wala's children in order of birth were Suasami Aava, male, Aano Tamali'i, male, and Muliavailele, female. Malo Mamai's child was Saolatitele'u Pengaufiti, male. These names were naturally Samoan names whose meanings recorded place and genealogy. Suasamaim Ava refers to both seawater and Ava. The significance of the coupling of seawater and Ava here is lost. Nevertheless, what is clear from the name itself is the significance given to remembering the Ava. Ano Tamali means a fresh Ano of the chiefs, metaphor for the long-stemmed Ava root used in the Ava ceremony. Muli of Vailele is a name that records the village Vailele, the ancestral village of Wala, and Sao Latitele Upengo Fichi is a name that pays tribute to the progenitor reach of the Tuifiti. The two sisters and their children lived happily in Fiji. One day, the Wa'ano Tamali, before he passed away, gave his last dying wish to his sister, Muli o Vailele. He said, "Dear sister, I want you to bury me in the Balusanga, in the kitchen area. After a while, my flesh will become a plant. When you see this plant growing, I want you to dig it up and take it to our mother's village, Vailele, in Samoa. I want to plant it there in remembrance of me and Fiji." When Aano Tamali eventually passed away, Muli o Vailele shared with her family his mawainga, his dying wish. They prepared themselves for his burial. As was his wishes, they buried him in the Balusanga, something unheard of for a noble, and each day they looked out for the shoots of a plant. One day, Muli o Vailele saw a strong shoot growing out of the ground where Aano Tamali was buried. She declared, "Watoyola mai Aano Tamali. Aano Tamali has come back to life." As promised, they dug up the Aano Tamali, the Ava plant, and prepared to take him back to Samoa. When they arrived in Samoa, they headed to Vailele. They reunited with their mother's families and planted Aano Tamali in the place now known as Niniva, the village green of Vailele. The village green came to be known as Niniva because when rats chewed on the roots of Aano Tamali, they became intoxicated and dizzy, i.e. Niniva in Samoan. This story, therefore, becomes not only the story of how the Ava came to Vailele, but also about the genealogy and the history of Niniva and Aano Tamali. This story is explicitly remembered during the Ava ritual, when the spokesperson for the Aumanga, the entitled men's guild who assists with the ritual, makes specific reference to Aano Tamali. When a guest party's orator offers Ava to the Aumanga spokesman will, according to protocol, politely decline by saying, "Fa awal faso o lea ua ye Aano Tamali." "Please proceed with the distribution, for we have enough Ava for the Tanoa." There is a lot of meaning in this remark and its gesture of courtesy. It is not without purpose that it is the Aumanga that makes this explicit reference to Aano Tamali. One of the main reasons why Aano Tamali wanted to be buried in the Balusanga kitchen is because it sends a message about humility and service. It recognizes and gives high honor to the values of the culture of Ngasese, i.e. of service. Ngasese is Samoan respect for service. It is a Samoan respect term for service. There is a little moenga saying, "Elese matua fafanga ifali, ole matua ngasese le matua little moenga." The leadership of little moenga stands not because people serve them, but because they serve the people. This is one of the key messages of the Ava story, and is recognized by both Samoans and Fijians. It is also a message rooted in the vision and mission of the University of South Pacific, USP. That is, that USP serves the peoples of the Pacific, not the other way around. In celebration and remembrance of the roots of USP, I pay tribute to her illustrious leadership genealogy. I acknowledge all the former Pacific heads of state and heads of government who have given service to USP. From His Majesty King Taufahau Tupo, USP's first chancellor, through to her current chancellor 50 years on, His Excellency Taneti Maamau, President of Kiribati. I acknowledge all the vice chancellors, heads of faculties, schools, departments, program centers, and or units who from USP's birth to this 50th anniversary year served her or continues to serve her and her mission with commitment and pride. I am honored to have been invited to join you in celebrating this huge milestone in the life of USP. I remember when it was suggested that the dream to have such a regional university was considered ludicrous. But because of a united political will, we built it anyway, and now it continues to stand tall because of that sheer determination or will to make it work and survive. However, organizations like universities require more than political will to flourish. It requires inspiration from the top to the bottom to everywhere in between. The question is, where might this inspiration come from? For me, the answer is simple. It comes from within us. It comes from our whasinomanga, our roots, our identities as Pacific Islanders. It comes from our care, from our core cultural values, and the ability to see those values in our everyday institutions, workplaces, recreational places, worship places, in our pedagogies, methodologies, philosophies, and our creative arts, humor, and entertainment. My dear friend, the late Father Paul Ojibwe, a Native American Indian and Franciscan friar of the Atonement, wrote that we as indigenous peoples need to know and articulate what it means now to be home in a world that devalues, disregards, and disintegrates our ancient and necessary wisdom. We need to both intuit and know how reference shapes our self-identity and challenges the academy to change their presumptions and priorities about really what is the other in the history of our times. His words offer us food for thought about where our Pacific indigenous knowledges sit within the priorities of USP, our regional universities. His words are echoed by the wisdom of another delightful indigenous Catholic mind, the wonderfully unapologetic Igbo scholar, Monsignor Theophilus Okere. In 2014, the Monsignor reminded me that our indigenous references can't romanticize the past. It must embrace the good and the bad, the old and the new in our indigenous cultures to move forward. Our indigenous references have to be inclusive, he suggests, in ways that both celebrate our respective ethnic differences and our common humanity. That the verities of the old never really dies. They may change in form, but not in substance. He says, since we cannot turn back the clock of time and history to return to some pristine cultural purity, it makes more sense to embrace a project of enculturation that integrates something of both old and new to create an inclusive future. As we bemoan the passing away of the old, we may take heart in the immortality it enjoys in the project of enculturation that somehow knows how to mix the old and the new. More especially, let us always also remember that the old culture really never dies, but like the proverbial phoenix, knows to return from its own ashes even centuries after its death. We have a commitment to higher education in the Pacific, and education that truly serves our people have much to gain by being in conversation with our broader indigenous family. We can learn from and be inspired by each other. Tau mai na le pua e ula. Pick only the most fragrant of frangipani. I was recently invited to speak at the unveiling of the irrepressible Seyuli Tuilangi Alo, Alan Alo, a friend and longtime teacher of the Oceania Center, and someone who inspired many wherever he went and still inspires even after death. One of the highlights of my visit to Brussels in 2015 was his deeply moving choreographic dance story titled Moana, the Rising Sea, about the price of our modern conveniences on our oceans, environment, climate, and lives. His message was that even if the indigenous Pacific are not part of the cause of the sudden rise in the severity of climate changes on our environment, we must be part of the solution. The medium of his message was music and dance, his teaching site, the Academy. In my unveiling speech, I recognized that Alan had an unyielding passion for the fragrance of his art and for the rootedness of his identity as a Samoan and Pacific Islander. The ways in which he embodied these were inspirational. His life personified the motto of the talk, Se'i maile mui a'a, tau mai na'a le pua e ula, harvest the royal roots, pick only the most fragrant of frangipani. Alan knew how to touch the senses. He knew how to make Pacific art sing alongside the best of other intellectual and cultural traditions. He knew when to pick the most fragrant flowers and how to weave them together so as not to break them or make them wilt before their time. He moved with unassuming grace and was unafraid to speak his mind should he need to. In Aotearoa, New Zealand, Maori have had not only to speak their mind, but also learn the ways of the Pākehā in order to regain some of the cultural loss they suffered as a result of colonization. Last month, I had the privilege of participating in the deeply informative Pacific Philosophy Conference organized by the Pacific Theological College and others alongside Sir Taihau Kakure, Eddie Churi, Jury here in Fiji. I have been a longtime admirer of Maori activism and scholarship from the intellectually rigorous work of scholars such as Sir Eddie Jury and Sir Peter Buck to the political courage of Sir Maui Pomare and Sir Apera Nangata and many others since. When reading the work of the Waitangi Tribunal, I pined for a similar professional resources for our Samoan lands and titles court. When I sat in the Fijian Kaaba ceremony at the opening of the Pacific Philosophy Conference, I cried. I cried because the chanting was so hauntingly authentic and it touched me to the core. I cried because I realized that we in Samoa have lost so much as a Polynesian nation. My grandfather and his forebears not only spoke Samoan, they also spoke Tongan and Fijian fluently. While I can make sense of familiar sounding Tongan and Fijian words, I cannot fully comprehend the depth of meaning and nuances. We in Polynesia have a shared culture, the culture of A'anotamali, that without specific intervention will for future generations move increasingly out of their reach. To address this, we must identify that which inspires, we must identify that which keeps our mind, body, and senses alive and anchored. Conclusion. By way of ending, I wish to dwell just a little on this point about our search for what inspires us, makes us alive with animation, while at the same time grounding us and giving us belonging and rootedness. To live up to your name, the University of the South Pacific, USP, and in trying to mark your place in the world of higher education, you must find your distinctiveness. To do that, you must find the roots of your soul, i.e. your Pacificness. In a review of the Fisheries gifted to me in 2008 by a collection of young Samoan scholars titled Su'esu'e Manongi, In Search of Fragrance, Father Paul Ojibwe makes a poignant point about our indigenous search for soul and meaning. He says, the extraordinary value of this collection and others like it comes in articulating the experience of spiritual, psychological, ceremonial, and cultural animation. That quality and capacity of imagination that sees the hand of the Creator in all things, in all experiences and all relations. Such animation comprehends an aliveness in creation and human relations that is medicine for the soul, so easily lost in our contemporary world that does not remember, does not embrace, does not find power in being a whole, rooted and loving human being who knows the search for the fragrance, the touch of gentleness, the hearing of truth, or see the impossible breaking into the ordinary. Unfortunately, today it is quite easy to get overwhelmed and paralyzed by the power and control that outside forces seem to have over our everyday lives in the Pacific. To have the emotional and political energy and resources needed to make a constructive difference on key issues facing our Pacific nations, from climate change to food sovereignty, self-determination, and/or militarization in the Pacific, we require enough inspiration to make, as Fala Ojibwe says, the impossible break into the ordinary. And ultimately, that inspiration can only come from within us, or within ourselves. My brother, a few years before he died, took ill. I wanted him to come with me to leave Samoa for New Zealand to seek further medical help. After letting me make my plea several times, he looked at me, and with a firmness in his eyes, he said, "O tele mana o seula wa ai mai meta ua leo langa nei ma o meta ua." I do not want to be distracted from what are the most beautiful things in my life, and what are the most beautiful things are right under my nose. My brother, in his own gentle way, was reminding me, "Se'i mai le mui a'a, tau mai na le pua ola. Harvest the royal roots, pick only the most fragrant on frangipani." In other words, be sure of what matters, and don't be afraid to fight for it, or even if at first it may seem insignificant or impossible. Soifu.
Thank you so much, Your Highness, for that inspirational keynote presentation, reminding us of our roots, our identity, our core values, as well as our servitude and humanity, and of course our Pacificness our truth, and of course, our alofa, our love, haftai lover. We now open the floor for questions and comments. So what we'll do, we'll probably have a roaming mic, which will go around. If I can ask, please, if you can raise your hand for some questions. And as you know, this is a very rare moment that we have His Highness and Her Highness as well in our presence. So if you can please make the most of it, would be most welcome. We probably have another 50 minutes. So if we can keep it within that time frame, would be great. So the floor is now open. Naka, thank you. Any questions? Or will I be the first one to ask the question? Because I asked the first question yesterday, Your Highness. I do have millions of questions, but I want to open it up. I don't want to be too greedy. And so please, any questions from the audience? And I'm sure everybody has a question. Thank you.
Your Highness, thank you for that inspiring message that you shared. I just have a question, and I was fortunate to be one of those who was present at the Indigenous Philosophies Conference that you spoke at in Suva in June. One of my questions is around transmitting or transmission of Indigenous knowledge to the next generation, and just, you know, how do you create deliberate spaces to ensure that there's that knowledge that's transmitted to the younger generation, particularly for those who live in urban centers? And I probably will ask this for people who come from villages that are in close proximity to Suva or in urban centers. We all know and acknowledge that there is, you know, forces of, you know, the modern progress that impacts on how this is transmitted. How do we ensure, as Indigenous people, that even with the changes that we experience in the world today, how do we continue to create deliberate spaces for intergenerational sharing of our Indigenous knowledge?
I have to apologize. I have eventually succumbed to the advice of my ear doctor that I have to wear an ear aid. I haven't put on my ear aid, so I have to depend on my wife to tell me what the question is. But if I miss out something of substance or something important, feel free to pursue your question. How do you promote the Indigenous reference with the young people in urban areas? Let me own up about my own limitations. A few years back, I was asked to do a paper on youth offending, and because I was head of the state, I had a whole number of people attached to me who were prisoners. And we had a wonderful rapport. And I got them together and said, well, we are family. And I forbid anybody to call you prisoners. You are in this household. You are my family. And in this situation, I have been asked to write a paper. And I believe you are the best people to help me, because there are jurists and lawyers and all other people coming from outside But they know less than you because they're talking about you. You're offending, particularly in the stats which have soared higher. It was a wonderful lesson for me because, for instance, now in sexual crimes, the stats are just soared. I asked them, okay, how, particularly the ones who were offended, sexually. How did it happen, etc. And I had a wonderful education because I found out that these watches and these a whole number of things that young people wear makes it accessible, makes porn accessible to them. And a lot of these crimes are initiated by arousal through exposure to this. Now, I might as well have been living in Mars. I'm getting on, etc. I had not been aware of this sort of thing. But this is owning up about ignorance. How do you get to these people? But it led me to a very interesting journey. It led me to theology, to philosophy, and even to parents. I found that a lot of parents did not talk about sex to their children. There is something missing here. In our indigenous reference, people are a lot more comfortable about these things, and they speak quite easily about it. On the other hand, in the Christian setting, this is not the case. And in summary, what I'm going to say to you, quite often, not only parents do not talk about sex, but even the Faithful Hour, there is a hang-up about it. And I believe that my friend Saint Augustine is greatly responsible for the hang-up that Christians have. So I learned something. But what I'm trying to tell you is that it's not easy for people of my age to be okay with the problems that face young people, and there's a lot of learning. So I believe that if we are going to make a real effort, we must start from the essence. For instance, now we have to start from the reference that God spoke to our forebears before Christianity came. Because that is the foundation of respect and love and appreciation of the gift of our parents to us. If God spoke to our forebears, then God must be present in our indigenous reference. That it is no less founded on love and everything else as anything that you might say. I'm a Catholic, and I told this story the other night, and I'll tell it now again. I talked to the Pope about homosexuality, which is rather interesting because it's a very controversial. And then it became very, very interesting. So I asked him, Holy Father, if you do not know, in my culture, there is a knowable and an unknowable. The question I want to pose, if you do not know how a man or a woman is sexually oriented, how can you theologize on the unknowable? Well, you should have seen his secretary. He almost had a heart attack because he was trying to stop him going there. But he was quite unfazed. He talked about it. But the most important thing he said to me, and this will live for as long as I live, he said, the most important issue is to identify love. And when you identify love, then you locate it in your thinking and your doing. What I'm saying is that if you are going to sell our indigenous reference to our kids, you must start from a reference where they believe that God spoke to our parents, that God's love and God's justice is as much in our culture as in any other people's culture. Let in fact, the search for love and justice is as applicable to the Christian as it is to someone who is seeking value, who is seeking guidance from his own reference. There's a whole number of things there. So if you want to begin selling, you must begin from the original thing. That, you know, even our language, it's not something that it came, you know, for the rain brought. It is a gift. And the reason, in my view, is because while God wants to talk to each one of us in its own way, there's an idiosyncrasy, there's an idiom, there's a sacredness in that relationship. And therefore, we invest that wisdom in our poetry, whatever it is, because that is where you can win people, you know, to the cause. If you can convince ourselves that there is value, that there is truth, that the search for what is fine and decent is as imperative in our reference as in any other person's reference and religion, that is a great beginning. I can go on and on, but then you'll get bored with my rubbish. So I just want to give you some leads of what I've learned about. It's not an easy thing to do, and particularly now, because the children are very much independent in a way that it wasn't so in my case. I have children and grandchildren who are whiz in computers and all these things, and it's amazing what is available to them. And this, you have to try and catch up. I noticed my wife is beginning to make a point. You're talking to her. Okay, I'll stop here. But I'm trying. I just want you to know I'm trying.
More questions, please. With their questions. Johannes, first of all, I just want to acknowledge your special time with us tonight, and especially giving us so much wisdom that we have been thinking of since many, many years. For me, today, I just want to share a few things before I ask a question. I was fortunate to be part of the Waka Pacific conference last month, and I was
I was part of the talk story, and I was sharing Valenikuru Neimbungu. This talk story was part of our curriculum in Fiji, and I'm a primary school teacher, and it is part of our year 5 Beka Vakaviti. It's one of the topic. And I've been trying to find out where this, how was it invented? Who was the first to invent this Valenikuru? Because I believe that we used to cook outside. And today I heard that it was a death wish to be buried in the Valenikuru or the Vale. Valusanga, it's called the Valusanga. And in my message, in the talk story, I still believe there's still something hidden inside the Valenikuru. And now I know the real wisdom inside the Valenikuru. My question is there any advice how or who invented this? Because I used to say that it was after when we grow up till marriage, there's a different maturity there. And when you are a grandparent, there's another form of maturity. Maybe those are the ones who invented the Valenikuru, or only was it a death wish? Thank you.
Anotamani, about being buried in the Valusanga, and he's asking, is that really genuine?
The significance of being buried in the Valusanga is something that's worth commenting about. The Valusanga is... in our language, it's the shavings from, so that in our in my day, when I used to be out there, we would take the shavings and put them in a bit of a hole that is like a compost. And it was fertilizer for our ufi, we plant around, you know, to fertilize these things. So in this story, it emphasizes the importance of service, because particularly in the Umu, because this is where, you know, you have the thing, and then you have the Valusanga where the shavings are taken to, and then they're brought out to fertilize certain plants, etc. But what is important in our culture here is the loving. It starts from parents. Parents' love for their children and the children's love for their parents. This is core stuff. And one of the most important ways that you express your love for your parents is the service that you do in and this is why the word ngasese, the service in the kitchen, etc., is quite important. And it's important today also because people get paranoid. I was in power for a while, so I know, you know, how you can get carried away with certain things. And sometimes you have to keep reminding yourself or try and get grounded, because, you know, paranoia is quite natural, and that's what you get there. But you need to understand in your moments of reflection. You need to reflect that, in fact, one of the most beautiful expressions of loving is the service that you do for your matai or for your parents or for whatever. Now, the point here that is made is that here is somebody of very high birth, but leadership is not about status. It's not about, you know, being a king or whatever. Leadership is about service. Even a king has to serve. And this is a point that is lost today. And this is something that is core to our culture. And we have to sell it as much to older people and to younger people, that the core thing is love, and secondly, it's about service. It's not about honors or let your some hive or whatever. Even if you did have that, you have to recognize that your greatest duty or responsibility is to provide service for other people. So that is the significance of this story, the Valusanga. You know, he wants to be buried where he labored in love for his matai or for his parents. So there is a significant symbolism in that. And this is, when you're telling stories to young children, you must tell not only what happened, but also the symbolism, the nuances, the underlying points about the... For instance, now, take something I was explaining, trying to explain, in Christian ritual, one of the most important things in philosophy is moving from death sad to death triumphant. And this is signified very well in the rituals, the moving from there. And in our chanting, particularly in some of our beautiful songs, you move from death sad to death triumphant by intonation. One is buoyant and alive, and the other one is waiting. There are these very important lessons, because I'm talking to you, and the question that came to me, how do you sell this to your kids? You have to sell them with love about the beautiful lessons there, that in fact you find yourself, you find your redemption, you find your blessings, you know, by the service and the love that you give to your parents first and then to the other leaders as well. And this is the, and that is a lesson that is as applicable to families and homes and whatever as it is to the university. The foundation principle of our culture should find its way into the academic curriculum, into the values and vision. Now, this is another thing that I want to emphasize in what I'm talking about. What I'm saying is that I'm addressing the issue that was posed earlier on. How could you sell this to your children? It's not only at the family level, it's also at the educational level, right up there, the values that are promoted. It's the same with all other cultures. I mean, whether it's their music, their poetry, I find that when I go to England during the summer or, the spring, I love going up to the Lake District, because I love the poetry. And there's an ambience there that underlines it. I say to myself, I have to do this with my own history and the stories about my family. So now I go there and I find encouragement and inspiration by understanding and trying to take that too. Because these mean a lot to us. Even the music that, you know, Alan has did, it's because it speaks to the heart. It speaks, you know, to something very important in us. And I wish that more of you were there, or you might see it in a film, the performance in Brussels. and the way the people stood up, you know, and I was filled with joy and pride, and that was inspired by work from this university, and this is, there should be more of that, because you are celebrating something which has global or universal application, because people in the end are the same everywhere. They want something that touches the mind, that inspires the heart, that warms, you know, the better side of our nature. And it's no different. If you are, and the fact is, it's more difficult because of globalization. You have English everywhere, and you have them selling this down to our children. If you want our children, you know, to love the things that we love, then you must spend time to tell them the parable, the beautiful stories about, you know, our own culture, and glean out of that the wonderful meanings that are in there.
Johannes, thank you very much for the wonderful speech you gave tonight. Few themes that, as a young person, that I've learned from your talk tonight was how you address on indigenous knowledge and how it has to be inclusive, and of its nature of acceptance, embracing a culturalization, mourning the passing of the old and embracing of the new, of how you also talked about finding our distinctiveness in a world of chaos and diversity. And my question to you, Johannes, this evening is, do you think the university has done enough when it comes to indigenous knowledge, research, and teaching? And what is your advice to us young people and aspiring scholars in advancing the cause of indigenous knowledge in the Pacific?
Let me talk about climate change.
You think the university has done enough?
What?
He's asking whether you think the university has done enough for indigenous programs, and what is your advice about them and the research?
Yeah, well, I can only try and help. You know, the last thing I want to is to pose as an academic, because what I'm trying to say is that we have, you would see in a lot of my writings, I write about climate change, etc. But what I'm trying to do is to sell the beautiful stories of our philosophies, our theologies, that tells us that the affinities between man and the environment, you know, the respect that you have to pay, you know, that, you know, if you look at one of our greatest achievements as Pali people, it's through navigation. You know, we brought ourselves and discovered a quarter of the globe and peopled, you know, all these places before the Europeans and the Africans discovered Canary Islands. Now, the reason why they achieved that was because of a conversation. A conversation ultimately with God, a conversation with the winds, a conversation with the waves, a conversation with the fish, you know. And all these things, this is a knowledge that hopefully we will be able to learn again, because we could find our redemption in that philosophy and in that theology. So if you are talking about the university and a message from the indigenous reference, there is a lot in that, take something in my lecture, I'm not trying to draw attention, in my lecture on theology that I gave a few weeks ago here, you know, you're talking about the evolution. And this goes back thousands of years. Our forebears chanted and celebrated evolution long before Charles Darwin. We talked also about the beginning of life, that they began with worms and with maggots. And people are saying, you know, science is saying, if you read the greatest scientists, Leon Napier, this is it. Well, why can't we celebrate the fact that we made this discovery long before this? You know, one of the greatest navigators, Polynesian navigators, is Rata. He went to Tahiti, to Hawaii, and down to New Zealand. We celebrate Cook. We celebrate, you know, Tasman. Why can't we celebrate our own people and their achievement? And this is what I'm meaning. If you want people to love the conversation that our forebears had with their forebears, you need to get your children to respect and love the achievements of our forebears. And there's a lot of it that is there. Somebody was saying to me after that lecture, he said, you know, Kupua, I want to celebrate, I want to get drunk, you know, and I want to tell these people where to get off, you know, because we have all these things long before they did, and I haven't heard it before, and I want another lecture. Well, I'm not trying to sell myself, but I'm saying there is some element of truth in that. So I'm still trying to come back to the question of indigenous reference, that if you are going to make it live, you must make it speak to our people, and you must make it speak in a way that would inspire them about their courage and about the conversation with God and the environment. And this is what is missing today. People don't want to admit that, you know, we're doing harm to our environment. People do not want to admit that, in fact, you know, there are these things that have a life and whatever that is divinely originated. And this is missing in the conversation, the normal conversation. And if you were to ask me what is the way they were by the university, I think that the university's visiting the reference of our forebears and trying to get into the anapongi that they had, you know, the ritual of abstinence and the reflections that they lived by. I think we will make, you know, quite a fair bit of headway on some of the really big issues that we are faced with. And my wife is beginning to whisper to me, you know, I'm talking too much.
Thank you. Thank you, Hans. We probably have time for two more questions. So can we see an indicator? Thank you.
Your Highness, thank you very much for the speech this evening. I am privileged to have listened to you during the Pacific Philosophies Conference, and last night during the Talanoa session, and tonight as well. And a lot of wisdom has been imparted to us. I am from Tuvalu, a country which is threatened by climate change, and thank you for mentioning that. I am researching into traditional and indigenous wisdoms and knowledge and spirituality as forms of understanding and interpreting climate change from a theological perspective. Your Highness, I would like to hear some advice from you on the indigenous spirituality, knowledge, and wisdoms against the climate change scenarios. We have tons and tons of views from other regions and their perspectives. It is very hard and difficult to find written resources on how our wisdom and our knowledge views this phenomenon. So I'm seeking your advice on that. Thank you very much.
Well, I want to tell you that I think a lot of you about you and your problem, because we are kin, and we have in many ways a common culture, a common language, and you know, the core of our culture is expressed through something as basic as, you know, birth, where you pulls in your umbilical cord and your and the placenta of your mother and into the earth, and that is the core principle, one of the main core principles of our lives. You know, the connection with the land. And that it is something that, you know, it's about not only our genealogy, etc., etc., but it's about a continuing conversation. You know, we're supposed to, in our culture, you know, be talking to our parents in our Moimana Dunatu and in our Anabongi. So when you have the prospect of being deprived of your land, it is hard, you know, to measure the spiritual and the cultural bonding with your people, your history, and your forebears. So my commitment to climate change issue, and I've taken a roll over the place and spoken about this, is not only for the world generally, but, you know, you start with your own family. I mean, we're probably the most vulnerable to the climate change disaster than anybody else, and particularly from your area. So we have to keep on working together. I think that and what is happening today is a lesson. For instance, now on the climate change, you know, the Paris Accords, etc., etc. Now it's you know, up in the air at the moment. But there is something very redeeming about the fact that there is a general recognition of the danger and how no one particular group can provide the answer. We need to unite as a community, as co-inhabitants of this earth, to find a solution to this problem. So that's not going to be an answer, you know, but what I'm saying is that I bear in mind what your problems, and I remember you when you speak about it in the forums around the world, And I pray, I pray for you, because what is happening to you is beginning to happen to us. Hopefully, the world will realize the dangers and work together, cooperate, you know, to find something to solve their problem and also ours.
And just for the final question, please.
Thank you, Your Highness, for the very inspirational speech. If I may be allowed to just make one small comment and then ask a question, I want to go back to this idea of the Valusanga, because I, like you, sir, I do believe that that's where some of the answers that we are looking for may lie. Just to elaborate for the non-Samoans, the Valusanga is like in a cookhouse. You have a kind of a stick you put into the ground, and on the top of that stick you balance the whether the breadfruit or the taro as you scrape it. As you do that, if you're not careful, you get a lot of sap from the breadfruit on your hands, and it's very unsightly and very sticky. With the taro, it gets very, very itchy if you're not careful. So my take on that is that it's not only hard work, it's also painful work. And so when I look back into my faith as a Christian, and I consider the cross as a kind of a wood of sacrifice, and I listen to the description of climate change as an inconvenient truth, I begin to appreciate that in indigenous knowledge, as you described, Your Highness, the notion of work, the notion of service, sacrifice, is what we have forgotten. As you very well described in the history of the Kava, the root, the royal root, comes from sacrifice, service, and pain. It's a bit like the Christian. It's like the Christian. So my question, Your Highness, is can you see in the kind of indigenous knowledge you described tonight, and the leader-servant philosophy of Christianity, especially in the ministry of Jesus, a possibility of these two seemingly different philosophies coming together to promote the idea of leader-servant, sacrifice, and the ability to accept inconvenience of life, which seems to be what's in front, or what's stopping us from making these changes that is needed to address climate change, for example.
Yeah, well, the thing is that what is important here is service, and what is also important here is that the son of the king, you know, opts to bury, have himself buried in the Valusanga, which is a celebration of service to his father or to the title holders. And the other thing about our community is that there is a sense that people, you know, you have the saying in Samoa, and that applies to everybody. Whether you're high ranked or whatever it is, the road to leadership is through service. And that is one of the lessons here, that true leadership is not about rank or whatever, it's about the service that you provide. And what we're trying to say to this institution is that they have to have the humility to understand that if they are going to lead, they serve. They are not the people that the community serves. No, essentially they have to recognize, and we as well have to recognize that whoever we are, if we want to lead, then we must learn to serve. And that is a point that is made in very, very significantly in that story, that nobody is excused from service. In fact, the higher you are, the more the obligation to serve falls on you. But the point is, again, true leadership is not based on status. True leadership is founded on service.
Thank you so much, Your Highness, and thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for the stimulating questions. And unfortunately, we have to bring it to a close. I would just like for this evening, it gives me great pleasure to invite the Vice Chancellor and President, Professor Rajesh Chandra, to deliver the vote of thanks.
Le Apionga, Ale Tama A Inga, His Highness Tui Atua Tupua Tamasese Taisi Tupuola Tufunga Efi, and Masiofo Filifilia Tamasese, the Pro Chancellor and Chair of Council, Mr. Winston Thompson, distinguished guests, staff and students, ladies and gentlemen. We have all been very privileged and humbled this evening. Your Highness, with your lecture and for your willingness to share so much knowledge and wisdom with all of us. And for me, it's an exceptional privilege to be asked to move a vote of thanks. And also, it has been a personal privilege for me, Your Highness, to have served under your chancellorship. And I'd like to thank you very much for that privilege and for your leadership during your term. Your lecture today is a very timely reminder of just how much we can learn from the wisdom of our ancestors, and also how important it is to do so as we navigate in an increasingly complex world. this is probably the most enchanting and inspiring journey that we have had in an evening of feast, of wisdom, knowledge, of passion, about something that is so important to us. Your reminder about the importance of understanding our ancestors and the wisdom of being selective, the wisdom of combining our ancestral knowledge with the requirements of modernity, and the importance of choice as we select the fragrance that we use. Your message of inclusion and your message about leadership being one of service, they're all very important as the Pacific faces all these challenges. And I must say that your wisdom and your thoughts about what leadership entails is very important, as leadership is one of the challenges in our Pacific, as perhaps some of our leaders have lost that understanding about just how important leadership is in terms of service to the community. Your message, Your Excellency, Your Highness, messages have been heard very clearly, and I'm glad that in many ways they find a strong resonance with all of us present here and the university. The Oceania Center and Pacific Heritage Hub are central sections of the university, and they should lead these kinds of discussions and dialogue as we ourselves think about our new strategic plan. As you have seen and said, Your Highness, the university has had an impact in this sphere of Pacific art, culture, and identity and heritage. But it is a very relevant question for all of us to ask as we plan the new strategic plan, whether we are embedding the university enough in the context that you have been speaking about. You will be pleased, Your Highness, that in the new strategic plan, the area of Pacific art, culture, identity, heritage, and Pacific studies are being given even greater priority, because we need to produce Pacific graduates who are competent and comfortable in the world that we live in, and importantly, the world in which the younger generation is going to be living in. But also Pacific Islanders who are anchored very strongly in their own Pacific cultures and societies. And I think that the university is tracking relatively well in that, and this is a good time to have this kind of discussion, so that we, when we are doing our consultations and we are trying to ask ourselves that question, given the responsibility and the unique responsibility of a university like the University of the South Pacific, are we navigating that well? Are we providing the resources? And are our students and staff doing enough to get to the stage that we all want to? So, Your Highness, thank you very much for sharing your lifetime of wisdom, sharing with us the passion. I mean, it's an enchanting evening for all of us. Thank you very much indeed. Pinaka Bakalevu, Papitai Lava.
Thank you so much, Vice Chancellor, President of USP, for that vote of thanks. Your Highnesses, once again, on behalf of the organizers, students, artists, and everyone here tonight, thank you so much for being with us and for your inspirational keynote address. And just to let you know, there are copies of the keynote speech tonight on the table outside as well. Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes our program. We hope you have enjoyed, and I'm sure you have enjoyed tonight's stimulating conversations. And thank you once again for coming. Please join us for some light refreshments. Have a blessed evening. Faftai lava, vinaka vakalebu. Thank you so much.